Twit. Twit.
Roman Rexata is broadcast before a live studio audience.
Twit.
Extra space on the side.
Where? Oh, it looks different.
I know. Hey, everybody. Well, welcome to Grownman Record Night. We're doing a special Saturday show because we, last night, look at that. That was easy enough.
Look at that. That's 30 feet long.
Look at that.
I'm good.
I don't have a lot of exclaiming room, so what if I want to raise the roof, Steve? If I'm in here raising the roof, all that's off camera. Nobody can see me raise the roof all the way.
You're over-modulating like a mother.
Probably. But, hey, we appreciate you joining us. We didn't do a regular Friday night show. It was a girlfriend's birthday this week. And
hey, pull down mic one on the mixer.
You're asking for it. Dude. Nope, not there. Nope.
It doesn't sound good. No, not there at all. Over there. Yeah, the first one.
Very, very, very first one?
Yep.
Well, damn, it's on 10.
Yep.
Eight and a half now.
Okay. All right. So we appreciate you joining us. We took a little break last night, took the girlfriend out, did a little dinner. We did a little rock and roll show. Went and saw, if you're a fan from way back in the day, James has been on the program and I played in the Five L's with his cover band, him and his wife. Did a little cover band deal last night. We went over and enjoyed that and came back, hung out to like damn 5 in the morning. Getting stupid back over here. So it's, you know, I told Sean early on the chat, got just enough gumption to come in here and pour a little funny down my damn neck, get ready to do a little grown man record night. I put it out there we did a Captain Car Wash last week, and I put a little poll out there on the Facebook and say, hey, we're going to do another Saturday show. You guys want to see Captain Car Wash? You want to see a regular old Grown Man Record Night? We had some votes for Captain Car Wash. We had some votes for Grown Man Record Night. But in the end, folks wanted to see a regular old Grown Man Record Night. Probably missed a little bit of the So to Speak and Chip Chat in there and some of the Dig of the Week stuff. Captain Car Wash is always a good time. But, hey, the regular Grown Man Record Night won out fair and square. So we came in here and did that this evening.
Five votes to no votes.
No, I think it was 7-8 votes. I'm like, yes, I mean, you know, we don't have a shit ton of people watching live.
It shows you how much every vote counts.
That damn straight, man. So we wanted to come in here and just make sure we everybody had their voice for this for this program.
Yeah.
Let's see. I got some stuff I wanted to talk about. And this stuff, we don't do this all the time. But all this is part of the In the News segment. So we're going to talk about some of the stuff.
In the news.
Since it's a Saturday show, I actually had a few minutes to dig around online. I had a lot of time this week, had some time off, then did some work. And so my head's been in the clouds. So come in here and looked up some stuff that's going on in the world of vinyl, the world of music. And we'll kick it around here in the old sandbox.
Okay.
See what the shit hell comes out of it. Hey, I heard License to Ill. The legendary first Beastie Boys album. It's going to get released. This is like brand new kind of news stuff. It's going to get released, I think, in October, like October 14th or something. And so it's up for pre-order now. This hasn't been out of print for a while, I think.
Yeah.
You interested in getting this, the first Beastie Boys? What do you think about that? Me and Jay were talking about it earlier.
Me, not so much.
No? A reissue of that, it would be cool to pick up. Maybe, I wouldn't pay a lot of money for that. But that's kind of cool that's going to be available for people to pick up.
Right.
Bossman had picked up that, I can't remember what it's called, the double LP, like kind of like a greatest hits, Beastie Boys.
Yeah.
that's a good reissue to pick up. You know, when you talk, it kind of covers a lot of different albums and some of the bigger hits.
Sure.
And without having to go out and spend a shit ton on some other stuff. But
so
yeah.
If you're a fan, yeah, you'd buy that.
Something else in the news this week. Kind of cool. In 1999, they discovered this asteroid.
JonBenet.
JonBenet asteroid. You know, we can tell a JonBenet story.
JonBenet Ramsey Lewis.
But I've got... No, I'm not telling that story. Anyhow, it was spotted in 99, the same year that Freddie Mercury died. And for some reason... Brian May is really big into astronomy and stuff, which
okay.
I didn't realize.
Okay.
But this week, to
astrology
celebrate...
Astronomy. Okay.
Yeah, what did I say?
Astronomy.
Okay. Astronomy Domini. This would have been... no, not 45. But... So anyhow, they ended up... They named this asteroid after Freddie Mercury.
They call it Freddie?
It's called... Asteroid 17473, Freddie Mercury, like all
okay,
put together.
Okay, all put together.
And
pretty creative name.
I was waiting on a punchline.
Nah.
Brian May commented on this, which is, it's pretty cool that there's an asteroid flying around out there named Freddie Mercury. But he was like, well, there's already a planet named after him.
Oh.
Wah, wah. That was Brian May's comment after that. Well, there's already a planet named after him.
Pretty cool though.
Yeah, no, that's
they named a planet.
Absolutely. Hey, look at these things, man. I'm drinking these alcoholic sparkling waters called Truly Spiked and Sparkling, which I feel like a yoga.
Say alcohol?
Alma-caholic. I feel like Alma Collins-ish.
What flavor is it?
It's got a little hint of lime, but it's like a sparkling water. Like
okay.
She's dead. Like a LaCroix or a Perrier or a... Pellegrino with a little hint of lime.
I could like to Carl did that.
Isn't Alma Collins dead?
Yeah, she is dead, Jay. Some folks were asking if we're going to do a 9/11 show.
Oh, that's good.
We're not going to do a 9/11
that's
show.
That's got alcohol?
I'm not asking if you want any, Jay. Hold that shit up there.
That just tastes like sparkling water. It doesn't taste like it's got alcohol in it.
No, it's... Very
dangerous. That might creep up on you.
It's 5%, so it's like...
Where'd you get that?
This Harris Teeter.
And what was the brand? Truly.
They're not cheap, but I'll tell you, man, it's 100 calories, 2 carbs per bottle, and it tastes like water. It doesn't like load you down like you've been like chugging loaves of bread all night. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I got some IPAs in there, and I love my damn IPAs, but
chugging loaves of bread.
You know what I mean? It
yeah,
feels like
right.
You've been shoving loaves of bread down your damn gullet all night, and sometimes that's not what you want out of your alcoholic, but very, very. Bubba beverage.
I'm going 80s drinking an oil can tonight.
Yeah.
Falstaff.
You like you ever had the green ones, the bitter ones?
Yeah.
Borscht.
There we go. I've been waiting on that one to come out of there.
In sports tonight, there was a lot of lame college games. Georgia barely squeaked by the powerful Nichols State, the Colonels from Louisiana.
Oh, yeah.
So we'll probably drop him out of the top 10 for that performance. But whatever. It's still a
game. Hey, Notre Dame won this week.
Yes, they did.
Girlfriend got mad.
That was
at
a
me.
Really good game last week.
Not really.
The Texas Notre Dame?
Yeah, not really. But, yeah. Because that's... Girlfriend got mad at me. We're both big Notre Dame fans. Her dad played for Notre Dame. And when we turned it on this week...
Is his name Newt?
I was like, maybe we can watch Notre Dame lose again. She got mad at me. I'm still a Notre Dame fan, but I'm just pissed off at the team, you know what I mean?
Sure.
That harkens me back to my favorite FDR quote.
Harken.
Wheel me over near the balcony. So let me ask your opinion. Big news this week came out. Speaking while we're in the news
big
segment.
Big news. We went to sports. But
iPhone 7 coming out. Not going to have a headphone jack on it.
Bluetooth.
You're going to have to use Bluetooth or a special like lightning connected headphones.
Sure,
what do you think about that?
Well, you know, it's proprietary, just like the other Apple products. And
would it keep you from buying an iPhone, you think? Knowing that you couldn't be like, yeah, man, let me see them headphones.
Well, I noticed the Galaxies are catching on fire.
No, the Notes.
Oh, is that, that's bigger?
The Note 7, tablets. Yeah, the big Note.
Okay. But I don't know, you know, whatever. I've been unhappy with Apple for a while with my iPhone, but
I think it's, I don't see any positive in them doing
I'm not
this.
One to run out and get it, you know.
Yeah, I've heard the reason they're doing this is that that's how thick they've been making the phones in the past couple of generations, was as big as that 3.5 jack is.
Oh, for the jack.
That's as big as the phone
yeah,
is.
They can make a flat
phone. Yeah, they could pretty much make a flat phone except for that. So I see that.
Well, and they got the iPhone 10 coming out next
year. Water.
Can't hear you.
It is water resistant.
Yeah.
Not waterproof.
I heard the iPhone 10, the 10th anniversary next year of the iPhone, so they'll have some major.
When I went to Wet n Wild last week, I really wished my iPhone were waterproof.
No.
You got one of the life-proof cases.
Yeah.
But you know, this is what, you know, me and the girlfriend had this conversation last night, and we were talking about beta testing stuff on the phones. Got kind of techie. We're talking about beta testing stuff on the phones, and I'm like, you know what?
Are you a beta tester?
I like beta testing stuff on my laptop and shit. And I'll download a program. I'll help SETI search for extraterrestrial, do all kinds of crazy shit when it comes to my laptop. My phone is built and comprised
needs to operate
completely out of convenience. I want everything to operate so slick and so efficiently with my phone,
right,
with my music and my phone and right, my social media. I want everything to be as intuitive and as slick as possible. I don't want to be testing shit. I don't want to be fumbling for shit. And that kind of pulls me into this whole iPhone phone, the earphone jack thing. I don't know, man.
Ooh.
I don't know.
Ooh.
I think that's a mistake by Apple, for sure. The telephone? No, toilet paper would be the most important invention of all time.
Who invented toilet paper?
Jerry Gergich.
No, Crapper invented the toilet.
Yeah. I knew Crapper.
Crappier.
Samuel Crapper.
Samuel Crappier. So yeah, so that's just some of the stuff that's been floating around here, and as I retched up into the world of the internet and thought about some stuff that's been going on in the world of music and the world of record albums. I thought we should discuss it.
You know, there's a commercial on right now. It's for some credit card. It's got the lady from Saturday Night Live that went on to do, what's her name? Tina Fey.
Tina Fey.
And
she's
sitting in a restaurant with an African-American gentleman. They're tossing titles for shows back and forth at each other. And He says one, I forget what it was, but the one she said was Sloppy Joseph. I can't get that name out of my mind. I think it's an excellent name, like about a guy who just can't get his stuff together.
Sloppy Joseph.
Me and my buddies used to call the sandwiches Messy Melvins. I thought Messy Melvin was a little more catchy than Sloppy Joe.
Oh, Sloppy Joseph.
Who do you know named Joe nowadays?
I may be using that. And not giving credit. I'm giving credit now.
Where credit is dudes. And the dudes
and
are
right
here.
I will tease this. We went to the inaugural. You don't say first annual.
Yeah.
The inaugural Grown Men Record Night bowling.
Butt Bowl.
The open, what do you call it?
The Butt Bowl Classic.
Butt Bowl Classic. And we do have video, and we're in the editing phases. I'm going to put that together. We'll hopefully have that on maybe next week.
We'll tease it in this fashion. We did everything but break the pins to slapping, too. I mean, they damn near kicked us out of there for just slapping the back of the damn lane so hard with the ball. I mean, I was curving, and I know Jay was as well, 2-3 lanes over, and then coming back, pocket, 1-3 every time.
It was good.
And then into the back of it, like,
We were double down in bets on 610s.
I want to do a bunch of steroids and try to join the PBA and be a very aggressive and over the top about it and get in people's faces.
An aggressive bowler.
Yeah, the really aggressive bowler.
Like the most aggressive bowler ever. They'll always remember that guy.
Yeah.
Like the Ty Cobb of bowling.
Yeah. And then we could get some girls to...
But you got to back it up with a good bowl, though.
And you back it up with girls that wear satin jackets that say Ty Cobb's cheerleaders on it. These Welcome Back Cotter intro jokes doing anything for anybody?
Ty Corb.
Ty Corb. Ty Corb.
Ty Corb.
Thanks to Carl.
Corb.
God bless him.
He's an envelope.
God bless him, man. God bless him. So let's talk a little bit about some of the record albums we played this week. Played some good stuff, man. God, I don't even have... Yeah, we got this in here. Played some, man, I've been in kind of a little more of a hip-hop mood. I was talking to Sean online here. Checked out the Jam on Netflix, which came highly recommended from a couple of different people.
The Jam?
The Get Down. What a great series. So I've been really feeling some hip-hop.
You said Netflix?
Yeah, man. It's so good.
Man, I'm excited. Coming up on BBC America.
Yeah. Well, you just went real white with this, yeah. But that's all
right. I know. I'm not that. But Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency. Are you familiar with?
No.
It's the guy who wrote Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Oh, okay.
It's a couple of novels he wrote.
Did you read all those books, the Hitchhiker series? Yeah. With the four of them?
Yeah, there were three initially.
Three.
They added another.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Excellent.
Like I said, I was in a big hip-hop mood. No, that's all right.
I saw something.
pulled out a little Cool Modi. How you like me now? What I didn't realize, if you notice in this cover, and we talked about this when I bought this record, if you see down here, there's a Kangol floppy hat in the bottom. Which
I
is
think that was a stab at the other...
it was a diss at LL Cool J.
Yeah.
And I didn't realize...
He's under the tire.
I didn't realize these guys were beefing as hard as they were back then.
So that's with such a clean suit.
Yeah, go up on that. See that? The Kangol on the ground there, Jay?
The ground Kangol.
Yeah. So as if he had run him over. But
or at least run quality. Over. He ran over his hat.
Yeah, he ran over his hat. He's got the quality. Wild Wild West is on that. Great track. He's got some good tracks on it. That was a fun, quick little pickup. Mm-hmm. This was the Dig of the Week from a couple weeks ago. Mahavishnu Orchestra with John McLaughlin, The Inner Morning Mounting Flame. This is the first Mahavishnu record, which has the kick-ass killer lineup. McLaughlin,
that's not the live
Cobham, Rick Laird, Jan Hammer, Jerry Goodman. This is the beef lineup right here. Cobham just kills.
Are you a Jerry Goodman or a John Ponte? Will you talk about this already?
Maybe. I mean, I like Ponte. Maybe more individually.
I came across that electric guitarist album that you have.
McLaughlin?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was disappointed. I did. I picked it up and I was listening because I remember you had it. And I was like, I can't remember if it was good or not. But it was kind of the title. I thought it was gonna be one of those just electric guitar. But it was.
There were parts of this album. I don't know if you've heard the first one. You have it, don't you?
Oh yeah, yeah.
There's parts of this that just like.
Yeah.
Killing, he's going off on it, but he does, and I like the slower stuff that John McLaughlin does, but
sure.
Is it good for a record night? No, probably not, but it's still great music, and I still think he does a good job of that, even when it gets a little sappy and a little corny, but sometimes I like, I listened to it earlier when I had some days off.
Yeah.
Crowded House, the big hit, the self-titled with... the big hit on it.
Yeah.
Burning Down the House?
No.
No.
Crowded House.
Never think of it because of what you just said.
Burning Down the House.
Is it that one?
It's right there. It's where that split in the record is. I guarantee you.
Yeah.
But this album, and I was going to talk about it because I'll just go ahead and pick it.
Oh, Don't Dream It's Over.
Yeah, Don't Dream It's Over. Which I loved that song. I loved that song when I was a kid. But that whole album is fantastic.
Okay.
I don't care. I don't give a fuck who you are.
That's a guilty pleasure. You're entitled to that.
Yeah, it's
I've
good.
I've got a lot of that.
It's solid.
You're solid.
Like, I want to hate on it. I can't hate on it.
Can't hate.
It's one I would have pulled out for something we're going to talk about a little later, which is some sleeper albums. So that's a little deep tease. So stay tuned for that. We've got some great stuff maybe you don't think about.
I got some digs.
And Steve's got some digs. Jay's got some sleepers to go with my sleepers. So it's a slumber party.
I think there was one dig in here that's what got me over here tonight. I wasn't going to come because I've got shit to do tomorrow morning. But there's one dig in
me
here
too, sleeping.
That I was so excited to bring that I brought it. And I'm hoping we'll play it right after the show. So there's a deep piece for you.
Yeah. All right. Hey, this is an original Grown Man. Man, I bought this record. My record collection was literally about this big. It's one of the first, like, wow, this is a cool album pickups I made. Mm-hmm. Frigid Pink. And this is actually, it's the first version of House of the Rising Sun I probably heard. I love Eric Burden.
So many people online think that's Pink Floyd.
Frigid Pink?
Doing House of the Rising Sun.
Oh.
They'll have it titled as Pink Floyd.
My mom actually had, and I have this up here right now.
That's an early old CFPG record.
I don't know where I got that.
Maybe.
No.
Let me see. Is it?
Got the tags. Got the CFPG tag on it.
Yeah, but it would have been in a Blake sleeve. I don't know where I picked that up, to be honest with you.
I like the little sticker on it.
Yeah, I was more familiar with their version of House of the Rising Sun before the Animals. My mom had this 45 growing up, and I didn't realize it was Frigid Pink. It was kind of coincidence when I bought this, and I thought, oh, this looks Psyche, blah, 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 and put it on. I'm like, oh, it is Psyche. And I was like, oh, there's that version of House of the Rising Sun, because I would hear the Animals version and be like, yeah, this is the song, but this is not the one I'm familiar with. And everybody was like, what are you talking about? Everybody knows the damn Animals version, you know what I mean? And
right.
No, that's the one apparently I grew up with for some reason.
It's an old song. It really is an old song.
A Boss Man was he was on the chat this evening.
Really?
He was coming back from Tennessee.
What's his deal?
Tennessee. He said the AC broke down.
Oh.
And I told him, I was like, hey man, hang tight, I got something for you, but I don't think he hung on there long enough. Pulled out a record he gave me a long time ago, a little Cool Breeze.
Cool Breeze.
For the Hook. Little 12-inch. This is
hip-hop?
Yeah.
You were hip-hopping it up tonight, weren't you?
Solid hip-hop track, man, for sure. And one we've not played in a while. We used to play this on Grown Man Record not all the damn time. That Watch for the Hook is a great track, for sure. For sure. And one of those I wasn't as familiar with. And, you know, the girlfriend's kid got in the car last night. You know what I told her?
Mm-mm.
I hit play on the thing, and I looked at her, and I was like, look up here, man, I'm in heaven. And she was like, what are you talking about? She was freaked out. Anyhow, I thought that was funny. Jay, you want to save this for later? I got a meatball sandwich in the refrigerator. Eat some for lunch, save some for later. That's my rhyme. That's my rhyme. You want to save it?
No.
All right. Is this what you would talk about as a sleeper?
Yeah, this is one of them.
All right, I'm going to throw the graphic up. If you're going to talk about a sleeper, I'm throwing a graphic.
This is J.J. Johnson. No,
Sleeper.
J.J.
Sleeper.
Johnson. Quintet.
Sleeper. GMI and Sleeper.
This was kind of special to me. This is my first and only Six Eye that I own.
Oh, the old Six Eye Columbia.
I saw that. That's when I tuned in to see if you were doing a show. I noticed the Six Eye Columbia was on the table.
Straight up bebop jazz record.
I love the cover.
Bebop as it gets.
Bebop on, but bebop on trombone.
Yeah,
I heard some good trumpet playing on there too.
It's trombone.
This is 19.
No way.
That's J and Kai. That's the J from J and Kai.
You're J. And
Kai. Oh, 19. What do you think? It's a mid 60s
probably. Probably early 60s. Yeah.
It's got the original price tag on it, though, which is kind of
wow. Mm-hmm. That's pretty cool. Yeah, show that bitch off. You know, it's funny Jay brought this over because I said, hey man, I don't have any digs. Bring some sleepers over. Hold it up there for a second.
Hey, let me see it.
Charles Barkley
on trombone. But the last time we did a Sleepers episode.
Oh, this is yours, here.
I pulled out that Jay and Kai record that Chris from Dixieland Farm taught me into getting, which is a terrific, you don't think of trombone jazz as being something you really want to hear, but Jay and Kai do it well, and I think that's the J of Jay and Kai, right?
JJ
from Jay and Kai? Quality business, man.
What's the guy's name? JJ what?
JJ Johnson.
JJ Johnson.
He blew his head off a few years ago.
Blew his head off.
Oh, he blew his head off?
You don't have to call me Johnson.
Sadly committed suicide.
Well, that's a good time to take a shot of liquor, Jay.
I'm happy. He sadly committed.
Yeah, maybe he happily committed suicide.
Yeah.
You know what they say? Life's like animal porn. It's not for everybody.
Did you just make that up?
No, I got to give the credit to Doug Stanhope on that one. I'm not stealing somebody's material.
That was really good.
He also
I don't have a shot glass.
He also says,
I'll just take a swig.
You know, if you see it, if you're watching a movie and it sucks about halfway or three quarters of the way through, it's probably not getting any fucking better.
See the guy that said that?
As an homage to Suicide.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's probably true.
You know? Okay. So it's like, that's your own business.
Oh, see, current Suicide?
If you're halfway through the movie and it sucks as bad as you want it to suck, you know?
These Suicide jokes do anything.
Here's
for you?
To...
A little that olive shot.
September 11th, whatever.
I love you too.
Is that the Otto?
Mmm. Mohalov Otto? Mohalov?
What do you call this with an olive?
Mohalov Otto. Wow.
Just do the old camera.
That joke right there just landed in a field in Pennsylvania. All right, everybody, just calm down. This is all in good fun here. Actually, it's not in good fun at all. I'm a fucking asshole. That's what that boils down to. Hey, this should have been in the damn sleepers pile. James Brown, who we all love.
Mm-hmm.
Grown men recognize you love James Brown.
Is that James the one you have, Kai and JJ, right there? The great Kai and JJ.
Nope.
Different.
James Brown, who we all love, but this is James Brown Plays New Breed, and this should be one of the sleepers, because this is a James Brown record. I don't want to say it's from 60. God, I can't remember when this is from. It's on Smash Records out of Chicago. Chicago. Whoop, whoop. There ain't a damn lyric on this record. This is an instrumental James Brown record.
Really?
And it's smoking all the way through.
Really?
It's fantastic.
It's just the JBs?
And I think James is on keys. Was that his deal?
Yeah.
He played keys?
Yeah.
Did he really?
Yeah. It's like an instrumental soul funk.
I'll say,
album.
Speaking of keys, I was watching the big interview with Dan Rather today, and he was interviewing Gene Simmons. They're playing them back to back to back to back because
on the next Matlock, one woman's frightening.
What is that?
Sorry, I hit some kind of Matlock thing. What the hell was that?
Anyway, Dan Rather interviews Gene Simmons, and he was talking about he was a huge jazz fan. He used to love jazz.
Gene Simmons?
Gene Simmons, and in particular, he gave a shout out to Jimmy Smith, who was my favorite keyboard player.
Sure.
And I was impressed by that.
Who'd you say? Oh, you said Dan Rather. Yeah. If you want to see something funny, go watch Larry King interviewing Eric Andre. That's all I'll say. If you know who Eric Andre is, you give a shit, go look it up. If not, you ain't going to get it probably.
Right.
But it's hilarious. He Eric Andre's his way through the whole interview. And with Larry King, it was just great. Keeping it moving here, pulled out a little 7-inch that our good buddy James played in the 5Ls with. Picked this up at a Secret Chiefs show in Asheville, I believe it was, and bought this at the show for me before
was
I'd actually
was
seen
it. Was it Asheville or was it in Carrboro?
This was in Asheville, I believe. And this is the Forms, I believe, version. There's several versions of Secret Chiefs and how they do shit. This is the Forms setup, and I don't know how to pronounce it or identify this in any way, shape, or form. But if you love Secret Chiefs and Trey Spruance and that whole gang, you know what the hell I'm talking about. If not, go look up Secret Chiefs 3 and enjoy their music.
Because
it's terrific. Because it's terrific music. That's why I do it. Pulled out a Frank Zappa that I haven't pulled out in a good long while. And that's the Studio Tan album. Now this is on the Discreet label.
Was it like 81 or something? What is it?
That's what I was thinking. Somewhere 78.
Really?
Earlier than that, yeah. Listen to side one. It got some great art on here. Now we listen to side two, because side one's got that Gregory Peccary track. It's like 20 minutes long. On the show, I steer
Gregory
away from those.
Peccary?
I steer away from those 20-minute Zappa track, because it can just end up being woo, 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 for 20 minutes, which is great.
You can always drop out of it.
True, but I looked at that. It's side one's got that one.
It was always great for like a 3 minute switch over. Yeah,
but I looked at side two, and he had three tracks over there. I was like, I'll play that one. But this is, and it was great. He played, did some really great stuff. Me and Jay were talking about the musicianship.
I think that kid's got a lot of promise.
Yeah. If he just stays away from those cigarettes.
You don't hear much from him.
But me and Jay were talking about some of the guitar musicianship from that album, where he was just blistering through some shit.
Can I see that?
And,
very underrated guitar player.
He's the king of kings.
78.
Or was that Jesus? What did I say? Okay. And Steve, you brought this guy over here. Now, what is this about? This is 10 years after.
Cricklewood Green, by 10 years after. We played a couple tracks on it. We didn't play the whole side, but I wanted to play it. I brought it a few weeks ago. It was part of my massive dig period.
That's right. I thought it looked Michael familiar.
I think I mentioned it was like their best example of their studio work. There's a lot of great. And I think I played a really long, like, piece, and then it played like a country piece practically.
It sounded like a country song for sure.
And we listened to 50,000 Miles Beneath My Brain and Year 3000 Blues.
I love those guys.
It's a great record.
That ain't no damn secret for sure.
I want to say it was 71 maybe?
Yeah.
I don't remember.
Cha cha cha. Ha cha cha cha. That's pretty much like
on Deerum, of course.
Yeah. That's pretty much.
Or is it Deram?
It's
Deram.
It's French.
I would say Deram.
It's French. Yeah. Thanks, Jay.
It's Deram.
So that's pretty much what we played this evening.
It is what we played.
But
you can't deny it.
No, not at all. So that tells me it's time to get into a little dig of the week. Now, me and Jay didn't really buy any records this week, so I said, hey, Jay, let's do some sleepers, and we'll come in and bring some shit that you maybe don't necessarily think about as big-time business records, but it'll surprise you.
Those
type records. And then Steve said he was going to come. Steve brought some actual digs.
I've still got some records to go through from weeks past.
You want to do dig digs? You want to do sleeper digs?
We'll do a little bit of both. I don't care.
Jay, hit us off with some sleepers. What you got?
Let's get into it.
Jay's got to go into the other room.
Let's just get into it.
Jay's going into the other room about it.
Well, I'll start with a dig because it's actually what we played tonight.
Okay, yeah, because I'm not even throwing the sleeper graphic yet. So go ahead.
So the last thing we listened to after Cricklewood Creek. Oh, Cricklewood Green. I'm sorry. It's called Cricklewood Green.
Yeah.
10 years after. We listened to a little, the Frankie Cap Percussion Group. It's called Percussion.
That's what you said.
In a tribute to Perez Prado. A lot of mambo.
Is that a command thing?
Latin jazz music on here. And it's on the table. We were listening to it.
Is that a command record?
No, not command. It's on,
I see those dots, I think.
Kimberly.
Interesting. I see those dots on the front, and I assume it's
Command. Yeah, it's got a Command art look to
it. Yeah, very much so.
Same style. Sounds you see and hear. Kimberly Records. Sounds in motion.
Huh.
How about that?
Very cool.
So, yeah, that's what we listen to.
Okay. You got some, Jay?
Yeah.
We got some floating around here. We got some sleepers. Jay's going to tell us about some sleepers. You got to get on the microphone. How many you got?
Five.
No, do two or three of them. Just do two of sleepers. Get on over here on the mic now. Get up all cozy on it now.
I brought...
Not close enough. There you go.
I brought this record that I got for a dollar. This is the one you see about everywhere for a dollar, and you see quite a few of them. It's the Roger Daltrey first record. I'm not sure the name.
Roger
Daltrey solo album. Daltrey.
Yeah, some folks may not want to take that delve into this solo shit.
Bought them for a dollar.
This is what his beautiful hair looks like from the back.
Yeah,
it's a very beautiful.
Oh, color. I'm familiar with that.
There he is.
These butt fucking jokes do anything for you?
Is it? Have you listened to it?
Yes. Very good, Steve. It was one of the early records that I purchased.
Track records. Track records. Track records. Track records. 1973, by the way.
That's that early for the Daughtry solo?
Yes, sir.
Wow.
This was.
So he was doing that during the.
Sure.
Hair.
Why not?
Okay. All right.
This is early Whitesnake.
Early Whitesnake.
Really?
Ready and Willing. This is 79.
79 Whitesnake.
Yeah. Oh, it looks
really,
really killer.
I don't know if it's really under the radar, but I just really like it.
Really Whitesnake.
Dude, I don't know.
Ready and Willing.
It tastes like Deep Purple.
Really?
It should.
Did I say taste like?
You
like
did.
It tastes like Deep
you
Purple.
You said taste.
Sounds like Deep Purple.
It's
well, you know, they have an album called Come and Taste the Band.
Dude, that's crazy,
like
though.
That.
I mean, if you'd ask me...
Has this got David Coverdale on it? Yes, it does. In fact, the sleeve concept is David Coverdale.
It's very organy.
If you said Whitesnake's first album, I would have said, I don't know, 85, 86.
That's right after...
Wow.
I'm intrigued by this album.
I am, too. I really want to hear that and see what that sounds like. I don't know shit about shit on that.
You got some more?
Yeah. Give me a wait.
I don't care.
Yeah. Hey, while we're doing sleepers, this is something we listened to just a couple of albums ago. Now, for some folks, this wouldn't be a sleeper necessarily. This is a present from the boss man. He thought it was a very important album that we have here. And he was always hipping us to the up and up on the hip-hop shit. This is Black Moon, End of the Stage. Now,
Black Moon.
This is how I was describing this, and I was mentioning this to Sean earlier on the chat.
Ow!
Oh.
And Jay just dropped the record everywhere.
It's 180 G's.
So, you know, for people that, I said for a rock guy here in the South, because I like hip hop a lot, but I grew up here in the South and I'm a rock guy. And so I liked hip hop. And I knew a lot of the, you know, a little more underground stuff as well, but I didn't get all of that. And Black Moon is one of those I didn't know shit about. And Boss Man was like, you know, that song, and I'm like, maybe I kind of remember that. Apparently that was, you know, if you're a real head.
What's the song?
Oh.
Love in an Elevator?
It's, fuck. They're affiliated with a boot camp clique.
Sorry, I shouldn't have asked.
Yeah, see, now you messed me up. There's
you look
one
on
song.
The record.
Yeah, I know, there's one song that's...
I'll get there before you.
Who got the props as well as the singles,
no.
Son Get Wreck and How Many MCs? Buck 'em Down and another Hot 100 hit, I Gotcha. Open. But this is one of those, he was like, oh man, you gotta have this one. And I'm like, man, I, you know, because he had bought us like
was
Beast.
Niggas Talk Shit.
Bam, bam. He had bought us stuff like Beastie Boys, Tribe Called Quest. I mean, a lot of stuff, Nas, a lot of stuff
was Shit Is Real.
Shit Is Real. A lot of stuff that I'm just like, oh yeah, I remember that shit. And I was way into that. Black Moon is one of those I didn't have any idea about. So. For me, and for people like me, that's probably more grounded, and us, let's be honest, grounded in the rock community, that somebody
grounded
something like this
rock.
Would have totally slipped through the cracks.
Grounded
for
in
sure.
The rock.
And we put it on earlier, and it's fucking fantastic.
Good.
It's a great hip-hop record. It's from like 92. A
lot of N-word.
A lot of N-word.
Sure.
But, you know, that's your thing. Say your thing. I don't squelch any language. But, I mean, I'm not going to use it personally.
I don't think my mom would appreciate
it. No. I wouldn't use it personally, but I don't squelch any language. So that's, say your thing, man. Like Jim Morrison said, no, man, say your thing. And the cops are going to arrest him on the stage. It's in the movie. No, man, say your thing.
So, it's in the movie, so.
Yeah, so it happened. Because when you say Jim Morrison, to me, that's Val Kilmer. Because I wasn't alive, and all I know is Val Kilmer.
He's Batman,
doing anything? I'm Batman. I'm Batman. How many more you got? Who's got stuff?
I got some digs.
I got three more.
I think it was a Jonathan's I picked this up.
Oh.
This is one cameraman probably wouldn't mind.
Oh, he would be all over
this. This is John Prine's third LP, I think, called Diamonds in the Rough.
What's it got on? You got Paradise.
The Great Compromise.
No.
Diamonds in the Rough, Great Compromise. Nah. Souvenirs. Probably nice. The biggest song on there.
Hell yeah,
he recorded that with his brother and Steve Goodman.
Oh.
Yeah.
Speaking of good Steve Goodman.
His brother's name is Dave. Dave Prime. And they recorded it in 3 days.
Wow.
So, yeah, one of those you just... Guys get around, sit around, jam. Is that what we're gonna do?
Is that a pricey record? I'm just curious.
It was, I don't know, maybe about eight.
Oh, okay, so yeah. It wasn't like a, you know, El Cheapo.
No,
a
friend of mine named Steve Goodman wrote this song.
Yeah, Steve Goodman. Another one I got.
Drinking that mineral water, son.
Was Elvis Costello record, Almost Blue. And this is one I keep passing on. I was like, well, you know,
I've
got all the records around this period, and I thought...
period.
I wanted it because I love the song Almost Blue, but it's not on this record. This is a very country record. Like, lately, Elvis has done a bunch of country stuff. He performed at Merle Fest, but he was doing it way back then, and I forget, this is 81. And I don't like it really because I really love the punk, the Brit punk stuff that he did.
Yeah,
pop this rock, is very, very Nashville country. And it's okay. I mean, it's just not,
even with
it's
that
not,
Nashville,
it's not what I was interested in.
Even with that Nashville polish.
Maybe one
to it.
Sunday when I'm listening to Johnny Cash and a little Merle Haggard, then I throw that on. That might be a good way to work that into the
but
routine.
Not if it's, does it have that Nashville polish on it too? Or do you think?
No. It's not like that.
No, okay. They're gonna say that Cash and that Haggard, it ain't got that polish on it.
No, it doesn't. Got the Bakersfield sound.
Yeah, and that's what you want. I want some country now.
Woo-hoo! Ha!
Sorry.
Loved Merle Haggard.
Ha!
It's a shame we lost him.
Yeah, and his denim dick, baby.
I'll do one more. Dick.
Okay.
I picked this up because you had it and I really liked it. Or maybe I didn't like it. I don't know.
No, it's good
but
stuff,
it's,
man.
It's the Hourglass. It's a compilation, 67 to 69, on United Artists Records, I believe. And what, you know, the Hourglass is pre-Allman Brothers.
Yeah.
Greg and company, some of the members. I think Dwayne might be in there as well. I don't think Dickie was in the band. That's a 1966. It's a 66.
Is it really?
It's the U.S. Misprint label. This is the one that's got a misprint on it.
It's look at it.
Bye Bye Bird is listed as Bye Bye Bird, B-U-R-D, which is a misprint. So, not that that's crazy rare or anything, but.
Steve.
What?
He's saying the record, the battery thing's blinking. Is it about to die?
Do you have a spare?
I mean, it shouldn't be dying. It shouldn't be dying.
No, it shouldn't be dying. I got three more. Go ahead and do something.
Okay. Well, back in our sleepers. We're going a little back
we're
in the
investigate.
We're going to be going back,
in the sleeper again.
Back in the sleeper.
No. That's the, there's no tape in it. The red, that's the tape indicator.
Jay, you're overextending.
That's a red thing beeping.
Yeah, you're a red thing beeping.
The battery's fine. Continue. Please continue.
All right.
This is a great, I think, which is why I bring it up. It's a great sleeper thing to bring up here on the program.
Sleeper.
And you'll find these in your local Goodwills and thrift stores and shit from time to time because of the amount of people back in the 60s and early 70s.
And they still do. They still do.
Went on.
But they don't sell records now.
Went on cruise vacations, right? That was like the big thing.
Into the
big new thing.
Into the Caribbean.
And what you would find is a lot of places you would go see these Calypso bands on your cruise ship vacations. And then you could buy the album from the bands.
I almost bought a steel drum when I lived in Athens.
Oh, yeah.
I wish I had because it was a steel.
Because, you know, Calypso music, island music, it's not reggae. It's not Bob Marley and Peter Tosh. But if you like this kind of music, which I do, I love the island style Calypso type music. I picked this up one time, and I've got several of these records, but this is the one I wanted to use as the example. Robert Roker and the Calypso Playboys. And on the back here, it's signed by the whole band. So the whole idea was you would pick this up on your cruise ship and then go up and have the band that's playing on your ship, sign your record.
There's even a square for autographs.
Yeah, which is so cool. And has my favorite version of Deo.
Really?
Ever. And it's so...
Robert Roker.
They do different things with the voice on that, inflection on the voice. But so
that's what's going on in the Caribbean. Here's what's happening in your...
And it's recorded live on the Norwegian Caribbean lines. And this comes from Souvenir Records does most of these. And I looked up a little bit about this Souvenir Records deal.
Of live records, that's right behind Cheap Trick, the Budokan.
Somebody got wild and wrote outside the box.
Yeah, gotta keep it in the box, kid.
So this is part of the Southern Florida's American Record Transcriptions Group, founded by recording engineer and producer Harold E. Doane.
Doane.
Recorded live on board Caribbean cruise liners and as a name states intended for the passengers and tourist audience.
I do know the passenger's name was Anne, because they signed it to Anne on November 1st, 1977.
But I've noticed that you will see these in thrift stores from where people will have dumped their personal collections.
She has an alibi.
That was November 1st, 1977?
The day before Election Day.
Well, the day before I was born.
Actually, Election was in 76.
But really?
This world changed on November
you were born 2nd, November 2nd?
But these are quality, I don't want to say, this actually sounded good. Me and Jay were talking about earlier. This actually sounds good. To be like a live recording on a cruise ship, they sound pretty freaking good.
Okay.
And
you wish you were on that cruise?
Yeah, sure.
You don't want to be on a cruise.
I don't want to be on a cruise. But I've got several of these records, and they're all fun records. And you find the, especially around here, I don't know, in your neck of the woods, maybe you've never seen one of these in your entire freaking life. But I see these around here pretty regularly, and it's usually on that Souvenir record label that specializes in this onboard cruise ship
shit. I see some cruise records.
Quality stuff to pick up. Give it a shot for a buck. If you don't like it, wipe your ass with it, send it to me, and then I'll draw a picture of your mom with a crayon and send it back to you.
Wait till the first day of summer when you're taking a day off from work and put it on.
Yeah, very
summery. Drink some coconut rum.
It's summery.
You got a lot of room over here, don't I?
Room. You got room to express. You trying to raise the roof? Raise the roof. Raise the roof. You want me to do another?
I'll do one more.
You do one more.
So, I'll do one more. This record, maybe I'd show this. I don't know. But I did pick up this Moody Blues record months ago at a yard sale.
Okay.
And I was so excited because it was in pristine condition, and it was a mono press of Go Now, the Moody Blues number one, the first record. But when I got it home and started to play it, I realized that it was actually broken. It was actually split. You can play the record, but you know, you're probably gonna fuck up your deal. So I picked this up recently, and I don't think I paid much for it. And I was happy to add it back because I really wanted it. I mean, it's not my favorite Moody Blues stuff. My favorite's, of course, the Mellotron out the yin yang.
Sure.
Stuff, but was glad to pick it up.
Okay. Let me bust another sleeper. Or Jay,
this is a repress.
You got some sleepers too, don't you, Jay? Let's hammer these out. We got to get going.
Where are we going?
All the way down. Now, downtown. Everybody loves some Blue Note. Of course you love some Blue Note. This is a Blue Note that you wouldn't maybe necessarily know about as much. 85, 86. Kind of recorded in unison with the Round Midnight, which I think it was the story of. Was it the story of Dexter Gordon?
No.
No?
Round Midnight, isn't that the story of Charlie Bird?
Maybe so. I don't know. This is, okay. The other side, Round Midnight, is an album by American jazz saxophonist Dexter Gordon, recorded in 85, released in 86 on the Blue Note. Was recorded during the making of Bertrand Tavernier's 1986 film Round Midnight, which had an Academy Award winning soundtrack that went along with it. This is the last album that features recordings with Gordon under his real name. And it's produced by Herbie Hancock. So it's a Blue Note, but it's from the 80s, so you're like, oh, yeah. Listen to the people that play on this album, okay? Blue Note, Dexter Gordon from the 80s. African-American gentleman smoking a cigarette, just saying that. Okay, Ron Carter, Herbie Hancock, Billy Higgins, Freddie Hubbard, Bobby Hutcherson, Bobby McFerrin got some vocals in there, John McLaughlin, Pierre Michelonger, probably McLaughlin, Wayne Shorter's on there, yep. Cedar Walton's on there. And this is a legit...
Martin Scorsese makes a cameo.
Blue Note, baby.
What the movie...
Shit, I had it on the damn graphic. Sitting there for fucking time. Hold it up there a minute, Jay. Give it a second. Slow down.
What the movie was about, and it does star Dexter Gordon, the guy Dale Turner, the character, is based on a composite of legends Lester Young on tenor sax and Bud Powell, who's a pianist. So it's kind of it's a fictionalized story.
Bud Powell, Round Midnight. Bud Powell is related to, by marriage, our buddy Teresh.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a fun
Captures account. The Paris jazz scene of the 1950s.
Okay. Jay, bust them up. I got the sleeper graphic.
Jay.
Sleeper. I kept the graphic up.
Jay.
Keep
Jay.
It moving. Here we go. 3, 2, 1.
Jay.
Sleeper.
Because Gordon was nominated for Academy Award.
You're nominated.
For Best Actor in a Leading Role.
I brought Death Symbolic, which is...
Oh.
It's not a well-known metal record.
What is
it?
Death Symbolic.
Death Symbolic. It's from mid-90s.
Terrific.
Symbolic.
Very well-known group, but...
This is not Death Symbolic!
That's because the lead singer is dead and not performing.
What, Death?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know. That's a great record, man.
It is. It's a good record. If you like metal... Techno metal a little bit.
Feel like 90s metal, like obscure 90s metal.
A little computer.
Yeah.
This is the Fabulous Thunderbirds.
Oh.
That's an early record.
Tough enough.
That's like the Texas blues.
That guy had the worst mustache ever.
Oh, yeah, real good.
No, and it went all down.
It's Jimmy Vaughn. Stevie Ray Vaughan's
brother.
Jimmy Ray Vaughan.
It went all down his business. I didn't care for it. I didn't like his mustache.
Produced by Nick Lowe, by the way.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
I got Montrose's. You gave me this one, actually.
I did give you this
one. That's Montrose's. I don't know if it's a final, actually. I said that before. It's one of their later records.
I had the Japanese import of this business.
This album's called Warner Brothers Presents Montrose.
Well, and you know, I'd always heard...
Looks like a movie
I'd always heard
poster.
That the first two records, they went to shit. But
I mean, they got their own thing going on.
And you got, Bob James as lead vocalist.
He plays with his keyboard.
And an interesting photo of Montrose on the back.
Yeah.
Showing some chest action.
Yeah.
Everybody loves chest action.
I like that Montrose guy.
Yeah, old Ronnie M.
He's dead, too.
Yeah, he is.
Yeah, he killed himself. Killed himself off not long ago.
Yeah.
I got some digs. You all right,
something? Do it. Do it, dude. I got two.
Do it.
This one, I'm going to need your help with.
Okay.
This one is actually a Rick Wakeman record.
Yeah.
Called No Earthly Connection from 1976. It actually sounds pretty good. I thought it would be kind of corny, over the top, prog.
Yeah.
It's not bad. It might be my favorite Wakeman solo record. The weird, stupid, gimmicky thing about it is it comes with this piece of foil.
Weird.
And it says, what's the little sticker say? Something about the foil, like come watch the cover come to life.
I've never seen this.
So I've got this. It came with this piece of foil.
Foil.
Just a nothing up my sleeve. Just a normal piece of like a floppy piece of foil. Or reflective. So what you're supposed to do is, I think you're supposed to roll, you're supposed to get like a piece of toilet paper roll or something.
Yeah.
Actually tape this to
Boogie.
It. But then you've screwed up your album cover. So if you look, see if you can, you're supposed to put this over the hole and then look at the foil and see Rick Wakeman kind of stand up.
Oh, my gym coach used to play this game. But he stuck his dork in there.
And then on this side, you can see his face.
I can see junk spilling.
You can't see it because you're on the other side. Can you see anything?
Oh, I see it.
Came to life.
Ah, right, rock and roll. I saw it. I saw it. I saw it. Oh, but I've been steady on drugs since the 90s, so that ain't no telling. Wow, that's awesome.
That's kind of cool.
That's
just
pretty neat.
Just a few bucks. It was cheap.
Yeah.
I got one more.
Go ahead and do yours, and I'll finish. Yeah. Is it a good one or a super bit?
Super good one.
Okay, well, I'll do this. All right, I'll do mine then. I'm going back to the sleeper graphic.
This one
then
wasn't a dig. It's more of a, I'm going to buy this.
Okay, I'm going back to one more sleeper. This was actually VCLT from our good buddy Scott, who was on the stream here earlier, sent this to us, Sunday Funnies. And when he sent this to us, I didn't know shit about this. I was like, oh, okay, cool. And I kind of acted like, oh, right. And I looked it up, and I'm like, I don't know anything about this. And I looked up Sunday Funnies, and if you look, it's on the Rare Earth label.
Okay, Rare Earth label.
Yeah. So these guys are Detroit kind of pop psychedelic artists. And they released heavy music in 1970, and this one was with 71. And then Benediction in 72, which was like their swan song, and they were done.
It's like psychedelic?
It's psyche blues pop kind of stuff.
Okay.
Quality shit, man, that I've never, ever, ever heard of other than getting this shit in the mail, which was cool. Now let me tell you, the guy that plays keys in this shit, Richard Kaczynski? Richard Kaczynski. He did the music for Pound Puppies, Legend of Big Paw, and Hanna-Barbera's Gravedale High. Isn't that cool?
Mm-hmm.
He did cartoon music.
Oh,
this
nice.
This is one that's, show that gatefold at all. Did you do that? You didn't do nothing, Jay. Why are we paying you anything? Half-assing shit.
I noticed your curbs look good out front.
Yeah. It's slick. Yeah, so it's a great record, and we really appreciate Scott sending it to us, man. It's, it's very rare that, at least when people send me shit normally, I'm like, oh, I know who this is, but I'm not familiar with them. That's one of those I'm just like, I don't know. All right, finish us off here,
all right,
Steve. I'm going to do...
This is the reason I came over here.
I'm going to do alcohol.
It's this here record. I was just digging around and looking at some new records, actually. And I came across this one, and I realized I'd seen a video the week before of them performing. What it is it's Les Claypool and Sean Lennon.
Oh.
It's called the Claypool Lennon Delirium, and I really enjoyed the video. But I was like, I bought the record, you know, not really knowing what it was, but it's pretty amazing. This is on ATO Records. I think it came out 2016, and it's what it is Primus and Sean Lennon's band Ghost of a Saber-Toothed Tiger were touring, and then Primus was taking some time off, and I think Claypool was trying to get his band Oysterhead together.
Yeah,
that little operation, but it failed. And so he was talking to Sean, and Sean's like, "Well, I'm not, you know." He's like, "You doing anything?" He's like, "I'm not doing anything. Why don't we get together?" So what they did, and this is what hooked me big time, was they put together what they call an old school approach to a psychedelic space rock record.
Okay.
You roped me. Are you saying? Like, you know, are you kidding me?
Yeah, you roped me in from
there. Yeah, so and it is really a good record. You can definitely hear elements of Primus and Sean Lennon, you know, pretty good musician.
Oh, sweet.
And it's really just the two of them. They share duties. I think Sean plays drums and mellotron and guitar and of course bass, and also I think Les plays the keyboards as well.
Nice.
It's a nice kind of a psyche gold orangey thing going on.
That's a good looking record.
Yeah, so we'll play some Whitesnake, and then we'll maybe trip over to listen to the space
that's
rock
perfect
record.
That sounds perfect. That's a perfect, oh, that's a great dig of the week.
I'm going to try not to share my pants.
Yeah, except it's like an hour already. We're already in an hour.
Okay.
So here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a quick break. Appreciate you guys stay with. So we're going to take us a break, and then we're going to come back here and do us a, so to speak, chip chat, and we're going to listen to some more music albums. So we appreciate you. And like I said, thanks for staying with us, and we'll see you here in just
did
a couple of minutes.
That? Did I show this record?
I think Jay did.
You did?
Did Jay see it?
Thank you.
Jay showed
it. My memory's not what it used to be.
My memory.
Look up here, man.
One step beyond.
Grown Man Record ought to be back in a minute. Stick around.
They sure work hard, don't they, Barney?
Yeah. I hate to see them work so hard.
Yeah, me too.
Let's go around back.
Well, we can't see them.
Gee, we ought to do something, Fred.
Okay.
How's about taking a nap?
Hey, I got a better idea. Let's take a Winston break.
That's it. Winston is the one filter cigarette that delivers flavor 20 times a pack. Winston's got that filter blend.
Yeah, Fred. Filter blend makes the big taste difference, and only Winston has it up front where it counts. Here, ahead of the pure white filter. Winston packs rich tobaccos specially selected and specially processed for good flavor in filter smoking.
Yeah, Barney, Winston tastes good like a cigarette.
Sure.
Mate, what do you do when you're surrounded by crocodiles?
Run, you slide, you hit the bump and take a dive.
It's Super Crocodile Mile with a high-speed air cushion bodyboard and super drencher spray. But watch out for the crocs.
You run, you slide, you hit the bump and take a dive.
Super Crocodile Mile with air cushion bodyboard and super drencher spray from Marshawn. Hey, mate.
Feeling good, fun time, playing in the sunshine. Family or daytime, wow, what a great time. Everybody playing puff-puff-golf, pun. Everybody playing puff-puff-golf. When it's good time, party time, even over daytime. Fucking time, fun time, it's a hole-in-one time. Everybody playing puff-puff-golf, pun. For the fun of it, puff-puff-golf time. Everybody playing puff-puff-golf. Feeling good, fun time, playing in the sunshine. Family or daytime.
Shira and I want to talk to you about something that's very personal, your body.
Remember, it's your body and no one should touch you in a way that you feel is wrong.
I'll get anybody who tries it.
It's not that easy, Orko. It's hard for a young person to admit that he or she has been touched in a bad way.
If you've been touched that way, don't be ashamed. Tell someone you trust, like your parents, your doctor, your teacher, or counselor, or your minister or rabbi.
Right, Orko?
Right on!
Shira and I want to talk.
Okay, everybody, thanks for joining us for Grown Man Record Night. And don't let anybody touch your pee-pee unless you want them to or have given them adequate funds for them to do so.
Tell your rabbi.
Words alert. I don't have a rabbi. I didn't grow up in the Jewish faith. In fact, nope. All right. Soda speak. Now we've had a great soda. I mean, we picked up some great sodas here recently that we're just now getting to a few of them. Now, you brought this soda pop over here, Steve, that, man, it's very near and dear to my heart.
I think I picked it up at Rocket Fizz.
Soda store.
There's a bunch of them around.
Yeah.
One that's in Marietta, Georgia.
So what's this? You can cut that damn fan off.
This is...
the chainsaw sitting in the middle of the fucking floor.
Filbert's Old Time Quality.
There you go.
Banana soda.
Filbert's. Now where is Filbert's out of?
No. It does say distributed by Filbert Root Beer Company, Chicago, Illinois.
Oh, Chicago! What? So we got us a banana soda in there.
Filbert's banana.
Okay, that should be pretty damn good.
It's yellow. It's probably artificially.
Hell yeah! You know old bananas is gonna like this one now. But I don't think I've ever had a banana soda though.
I don't think I've had a banana soda.
Okay. Is it a cane sugar type situation?
No,
it contains... No, it's a corn syrup. That's all right.
I hope it tastes like a banana.
It's like a... It's a carbonated banana now or later. Now or later.
Now or later? Was there a banana flavor? Yeah, there was.
Yeah.
No, there's another banana candy.
Yeah, it's a banana candy. Tastes
it's that banana candy you would get at Halloween that was in the, like, the mix that you weren't always happy to get a lot of those pieces of crap. But the banana one was good.
Pull your teeth out.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's one of those.
Like an hour later.
Yeah, it's like an hour
later. But it wasn't an hour later. But it's a banana. That banana chewy. Yeah. It was that banana chewy little chew.
That's like a cream soda.
It tastes like a cream soda.
It's got a cream soda with
a
little
banana. Cream soda.
That's not bad. I don't mind that at all.
I don't think I could drink a bunch of them, but it's certainly, it delivers.
Yeah, it is, like Jay said, it is kind of artificial.
Extremely sweet, extremely syrupy.
Yeah. Tastes like candy versus like a banana.
Like you said, it's like we're eating a piece of banana candy.
Yeah, not like a banana.
No, that we have little pieces of threads and stuff.
Yeah, but it doesn't have that like a smoothie type banana. No. It's more of a banana candy.
It's banana candy.
Yeah, which is great.
The banana D.
I'm not mad at this at all.
Okay.
I like it.
Well, we can proceed then with our
chip chat.
With the chippy chat.
Okay. Hey, we got Jay. Hang on.
What?
Reach right here and grab whatever we got open here. Let's show the open bag special.
I didn't know there was an open
bag. Oh, we got an open bag special because I went to Harris Teeter today, which is a grocery close to us that we don't go to a lot because it's where all the rich people shop.
Oh, yeah, those are good chips.
And
it's the HT brand?
Yeah, the HT Traders brand.
Traders.
This is a cheddar and
sour cream.
Horseradish.
Cheddar horseradish.
Try these guys.
I think I've had this. Have we done these before? I think we did.
Yeah, we've done these.
I liked it. I liked the little bite of horse on the end.
That swift bite of horseradish is great with a cold beer.
Well, I'll tell you about it.
I mean, yeah.
A little bite on the back end.
That's great. Love those chips.
Yep.
But we got another chip that we've not done this evening that we've been kind of waiting to do for the Lay's
the world thing.
World tour thing they were doing.
We tried to get them all in during the Olympics, but we just couldn't.
Yeah. So what's this deal?
I'm looking forward to this one though. This is the tiki masala.
Okay.
Which if you have any Indian food, hopefully you've tried tiki masala.
What is tiki masala? Tell me. I've only had Indian food one time. And I don't like it. I'll be honest. I don't like it.
I love Indian food. I want to say it's like a curry. Spices like turmeric and cumin. Tomato-based dish, tiki masala, is a fixture in global cuisine.
My question with the...
Open this flavor and bring some kushi to your day.
I don't know what that means. My question is when I ate Indian food was, why are you guys charging $8 for a baby food buffet?
Come on.
I can taste it.
Well, it's got an interesting smell to it.
It tastes like tiki masala.
Really?
It has Romanian flag.
It really does. It's probably the turmeric and the cumin.
Turmeric would probably be the one that would kick it over the edge. Here we go. Kind of clearing my palate.
I can even taste like the gravy. Because it's very, Indian food is very, a lot of gravy. There's like, you know, you get your basmati rice and you got your tiki masala
and you mix it in with your dirty sauce,
your paneer and your vindaloo and it's all gravy, like stewy based.
Yeah, and your dirty sauce. This doesn't taste like dirty sauce to you at all.
Mm-mm. It's great. I love it. I love that chip. Those chips are going home with me.
They're not bad. They have a little something on there that just...
Oh, you can't agree with?
Yeah.
Is that what's about Indian food you don't like?
Something in there that just really...
Maybe it's the, I think it's the turmeric. It might be the cumin. Oh, cumin. I'll throw cumin in chili.
Yeah, that is chili.
Well, chili spice is chili. Chili powder.
Chili powder and cumin.
And cumin.
And cumin is guacamole.
Must be the turmeric then.
Turmeric. That's it.
I love it. I love Indian food. But you're right, it's always overpriced. Buffet is the best deal. Go to lunch buffet and just gorge yourself.
Yeah. I didn't care for
it.
Can't
get down with it.
Yeah. Pretty open-minded fella. It's not my steez for some reason.
Mm. Okay.
But anyhow. But that's pretty good though. As a chip, that's not bad. It's not.
I like it.
It's not revolting.
That's a good chip.
Yeah, I like these better. That's not revolting to me, or but it's out of those. Let's think. Is that the last one we've done on the list?
I think it's the last one.
So which one did we do there?
We did the Brazilian whatever that meat.
That
steak.
Meat taste one. Yeah.
Tastes like meat. We did that one.
Yeah.
We did the Greek, which is yogurt. You did.
Oh, John Stamos's pupils.
You couldn't get down with John Stamos. What was the other one? Was it Chinese sriracha thing or was it Szechuan?
Szechuan.
That was okay.
That was probably my favorite out of those.
I might have to say this one is.
Probably the least, probably the most American and the least offensive to the untailored palate, perhaps. I don't know. But it was...
Untailored Vadened.
If you've not had your Vaden tailored, let's get on with it. Get it clipped up on you. Get it clipped up on you. It don't cost much to get your own Vaden tailored. Hey.
Sandy Johnson.
Already won the lottery. I was born in America and I know the Lord. Ben Carson. I met Ben Carson. He's an awesomely nice gentleman. Nice guy.
He knows a lot about Egypt too.
He loves them. He loves me, he loves them. That's all you need to know. Thanks for joining us for Grown Man Record Night on a Saturday. Loud noise.
How long's our show?
We're at 112 right now.
Oh, that's
not crazy.
Awesome.
That's perfect.
Let's do a finishing number.
You want to do a number?
No.
What are we going to do? We'll sing something.
We'll get around to it, though.
By the light. Of the silvery moon. we could have worked something up. If we know we had enough time, we could have worked something up. You have the age.
We should just toss this back and forth with each other.
You have the AIDS. You have AIDS. Not HIV, but full-blown AIDS. Thanks for joining us, especially on a Saturday night. Hopefully next week we'll be able to do it on a Friday night, but hell, who knows? There's a lot of hell and high water between then and then. Many a slip between the cup and the lip. So we'll let you know what's going on with us, and you can keep up with us if you want to.
Come
if
back.
If you don't, the hell on with you. Shit.
Come back, Teddy Bear.
We'll do us a show whenever we can, and when we can't, we won't. What you want me to say? Shit. But we do appreciate you joining us live on the Ustreams that we do every Friday night. And keeping up with us on the Facebook. We got the new website. We want people to submit some shit to. And I got some stuff I've been thinking about I'm going to write about on there. And some of it may get me put in prison. Some of it may not. So I'll just hedge my bets and do the best I can. And that's all my daddy ever wanted me to do right there. Hedge my bets, do the best I can.
Pray the river don't rise.
Pray the river don't rise. 14 rivers, 14 floods. Send my body to the heavens above. We'll see y'all next week on another Grown Man Record Night.
If you and Dylan more than 3 days, you causing trouble.
Damn straight. You shake it more than twice, you're playing with it.